Chapter 21, Gutenberg, year of 1840. Felix watched intently as the blank stride of paper was compressed under the printing press, given a pattern of ink. It became one of his latest works he had deemed ready for publishing. The satisfaction of getting it hard copied made him ever so grateful for the discovery of the press. The printmaster chose the next set of blocks. There were plenty of tiles to get what was needed, as much music had been printed before. The publisher made sure the pressman understood where the notes should be if a block needed to be etched or carved. As things came together, more beautiful sheets of music were produced. Upon holding a fresh, crisp reproduction, Felix felt a spurt of excitement. His mind sprang out with music. In a hurry, he raced home from the print shop. He sat at the writing desk with a pen and manuscript. A gleaming light from the orchestra came together in the form of chords, as if the sun were rising in song. The melodies poured like fine beer. It so happened that the coming June was the 400th anniversary of Gutenberg's printing press. Felix determined it to be the perfect opportunity to write a work inspired by such. He started making outlines, taking seriously the details of his craft. If something could look nice, he took the time to make it that way. His good handwriting he learned from Edward Reitz made the music look all the more artistic. Felix decided the work should be a symphony, a full one with choir. Since Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, which was the first to include the use of human voices, other composers began following that pattern. Berlioz was the first to coin the term choral symphony. Felix preferred his to be a symphony cantata in relation to Bach's choral music. To fit the theme of a cantata more so, he worked it out as a Lobgesang, or hymn of praise, basing it on biblical text. It became a large work consisting of 13 movements. To the average person, the score appeared as a large jumble, but Felix had it carefully organized. Felix's busy life by no means ceased in the midst of creating such a taxing project. There were still rehearsals to conduct, a house to take care of, a wife to tend to, and children to feed. The more Felix soaked himself into his regular duties, the more he craved to compose. All day, every day. Some days he was bestowed with his wish, but most days he hardly managed penning a bar. It seemed the seconds, minutes, and hours slipped away at each stroke of the pen. When he did obtain a day to himself, hours were spent at the writing desk in the parlor. He feverishly penned as to not waste a moment. The nice fountain pen strode smoothly on each manuscript, better than any old quill. At the noon hour, Cecil wandered up behind him. "Why don't you go eat lunch? I just got Marie to nap, and I have letters I want to write. You have hoarded the desk all morning." "All right," Felix got up, taking his papers to the dining room. Johann had set a plate of cheese, bread, and olive oil. 2-year-old Carl sat at the table, playing with his slices of cheese. "Stop playing with your food. Eat," Felix scolded. Carl gave his father a silly smirk, but obeyed. Felix ate while penning his score. Every now and again, a hum or phrase escaped his mouth in thought. Carl began to mimic, da-da-da. Felix couldn't help but smile, as his son had been progressing in learning to speak. Every moment of his small voice gave Felix joy. Felix turned to Carl. "You know, that was quite a good idea." He wrote a little segment of the phrase that made sense musically. Carl giggled, now knowing he had influence. He tried to mimic more to be funny, but Felix concentrated on his own mind. When June came, Felix's hard work paid off. He finished his symphony cantata. Despite anticipating future revising as everything else, he deemed it ready for the copyist. It helped hasten the process of preparing it for rehearsals. When rehearsals did commence, the days became long. Oftentimes, Felix was hardly home, leaving in the early morning to the Gewandhaus, only to return to his family at the late hour. His wife and children didn't like such stretches of time. One evening, at the dark 10th hour, Felix sighed as he walked into the house. Cecil sat in the parlor, sewing by the warm fireplace. The children were put to bed already. After Johann took his coat, Felix flopped onto the sofa next to Cecil. She glanced at him. How was work today, honey? Tiring. There are many upcoming concerts. I'm sure once these concerts come and go, you'll get a break. I hope so. Right now, Liszt and Thalberg are in the city. I thought you weren't fond of Liszt, Cecil indicated confusion, not turning from her needlework. Felix shrugged. I've become more acquainted. Socially, he has changed for the better. At the piano, his independence of finger can scarcely be equaled. The other directors insisted he come. Yet his concerts are at a high price, which of course is making all of Leipzig grumble. Thalberg, though, you would not believe. I find him the most superb pianist of our time. Later this week, I am to host a soirée for Liszt at the Gewandhaus, if you want to come. There will be wine, cakes, and music. I'd like to, Cecil nodded, finishing up and darning a pair of stockings. Felix brushed off all of his tiring thoughts. Anyways, how are the children today? Good. They went to bed on time. I almost forgot. You did receive a letter. It's from Herr Hiller. She handed him a folded note. Felix opened it and read it in quietness. The crackling fireplace gave a sense of peacefulness, yet the calm was disrupted by a light whimper. Cecil looked up from her fabrics to see Felix's face pouring with tears. What does it say? Herr Hiller lost his mutter. Felix felt the loss of his father flood back into his mind. Cecil set her stockings down and hugged her husband. They both snuggled a while. The next week, the street surrounding the Mendelssohn apartment was filled with nothing but musical passages of Bach. Felix had been practicing various fugues and chorales for the past 8 days. The efforts were for a concert at the St. Thomas School, where Bach had once directed. Felix wanted to raise money for a monument to be put up in memory of Bach as to make the place a destination. In turn, it would help the chorus there flourish. The school happened to be near the Mendelssohn apartments. After finishing up last-minute practicing, Felix packed up his music to head out to the school. Cecil gave him a kiss before he left for work. Before exiting the house, Felix paused, turning to Cecil. I wanted to ask, do you think it's possible we could invite Herr Hiller to stay with us for a while? I want to help him find comfort from his loss. I don't see why not. I'll have Johann organize a bed in the drawing room, as he did when my mother visited. Danke, I'll write to Hiller. Anyways, see you later. Felix gave a parting kiss, then walked to the St. Thomas School in gratitude. To his hopes, the concert caused a good crowd to assemble, all eager to hear the organ works of Bach. Felix took his spot at the grandest of all instruments, the organ. He set his music on the stand and began the recital without haste. The 9 pieces he presented earned him $300, a decent amount for a decent memorial. After the success, Felix returned home and went to the writing desk to organize letters. First, he read the received mail. Each letter contained requests to judge various music competitions. The composer Spohr was hosting them in Vienna. Felix had much respect for Spohr, but could not accept to judge such things. He had done so in local events, but after doing so, vowed to decline offers of competitions. He deemed them far too distracting, and gave an unwell outlook in composing for a prize. Felix set the business notes aside and grabbed a fresh leaf of paper. He wrote a heartfelt letter to Herr Hiller, giving grievances, then inviting him to the home. While finishing it, Cecil came into the parlor with another letter. She set it beside Felix as he signed his current writing. He then folded the letter and handed it off for Johann to send. After wiping away his mild tears, Felix opened the next note. It was another request, but not concerning music. He informed Cecil. The artist Herr Reitschel would like me to his studio. He wants to make a cast of my hand. That would be nice. A cast of your lovely piano hands. I have time today, so I'll go. Felix cleaned up the desk. He took the note with Reitschel's address along with him when going out to find a cab. An open gig passed by, so Felix boarded it for a ride to a quaint wooden home, settled between 2 apartment complexes. After knocking at the door, a man wearing a muddied apron answered. He seemed near Felix's age, and had a complexion of intellectual standing. His brown hair had bits of marble dust drizzled about. "Are you Herr Ernst Reichel, the sculptor?" Felix questioned. Yeah, excuse my messy state. Do come in." Ernst gladly gestured him into his humbled studio. It was a large open room containing workspace for sculpting and pottery. Living space with necessities such as a stove and bed were settled in one area. It was kept simple, as the main means of living was art itself. Felix always adored these artists' way of life. The workspace at the moment had a few marble busts in progress. Felix then noticed a bucket of plaster. Beside it sat a few casts of hands. Some were chipped, while others fine and polished. Ernst explained, "As you can see, I have been practicing hand casts. Ignore these chipped ones. Those were first attempts. I thought you'd be an excellent subject, as one of your piano hands would make a nice sculpture." "It looks like fun," Felix had excitement to dunk his hands in plaster. Herr Reichel mixed the liquid plaster and added water to keep it from hardening. He then had Felix dip his right hand into it. They waited until the plaster firmed up. Felix pulled his hand out, then watched Ernst take a different mix of plaster and fill the mold. When it became solid, he flipped the whole bucket to put the block of plaster on the table. He used a hammer and chisel to break it apart. Inside, the hand cast stayed in perfect contact. Felix looked at it with intrigue. "Surely I'll pay you for this." "Nine, it was practice." Ernst cleaned up bits of plaster, then handed the finished product to Felix. "Danke schön. I am primarily a sculptor of busts, so in future, if you need one done, come to me," Ernst mentioned. Felix nodded, then went on his way. The next week, I paid a visit to the Mendelssohn apartment. Felix had a stir of excitement as he showed me the hand cast. I found it quite interesting, but questioned, "Does not Herr Reichel reside in Dresden?" "He is visiting. His studio is set up in a fine wood home." "Intriguing. He is probably the best sculptor in Germany," I stated. Felix nodded, then mentioned, "Herr Hiller is to be coming today. He will be staying a while to heal from the loss of his mother. We should go for a walk, as we have time before he comes." He fetched his coat from the entryway. I grabbed mine and we headed out. It was a normal afternoon in Leipzig. People were at work, children were at play after their schooling, and horses clopping to and fro. We strolled to the markets to skim the fresh produce. Many displays were full of color. One young girl had a stand of imported fruits, many of which appeared quite strange. One sort had the colors of pink with hints of green, looking like scales. Felix picked one up. "What are these?" "That is dragon fruit. It's from a sort of cactus. They originated from Taiwan," the girl informed with bright excitement. "I will admit, dragon fruit is my favorite." "Interesting," Felix debated buying one, yet after seeing the price, discarded the idea. We took home persimmons and an assortment of wines instead. On coming to the complex, a carriage was parked on the street side in front. Herr Hiller climbed out with a bag of luggage. Felix and I rushed to him, greeting him with friendly embraces. "Please, do come in. A bed is prepared for you in the drawing room." Felix took his luggage in the house. Hiller followed him to get settled. Meanwhile, I set our market purchases on the dining table to share. I found a few wine glasses in the cabinet. Felix came back and grabbed a block of cheese from the kitchen storage. He sliced a few pieces of drunken goat cheese along with the persimmons. By the time Hiller settled, we had our wine party set. Felix wasn't hasty to start gulping down the aged fermented grape juice. He always swallowed it with immense satisfaction. Hiller tasted each sort before choosing one to fill his glass. I picked up a sweet red wine. Cecil walked in with surprise. "Felix?" "Yeah, honey?" Felix perceived her tone scornful. She came closer to the table. "Why didn't you tell me you were hosting a wine party? Can I join?" "Of course," Felix kindly stood and in a gentlemanly fashion helped her get seated. The rest of the evening was filled with talk, wine, and cheese tasting. The next morning, Felix, Cecil, and the two children sat at the breakfast table. Hiller got around to waking and joined them. Johann set out a simple start to the day with coffee, bread, and butter. The coffee was quite dark, so Hiller added much cream. The bread appeared light and fresh, with the crust dusted in flour. Creamy salted butter topped it all off. After Hiller took his serving of food, he noticed Felix dunking his bread and coffee like a young schoolboy, rather than eat it with butter. Hiller questioned, "Don't you like fresh butter?" "I despise it. It tastes like salted lard." "It does not. It's creamy." Hiller ate another bite of buttered bread. Felix rolled his eyes and ate his coffee-dunked bread. Little Carl played with his bread, causing Felix to scold the boy. Cecil was busy holding Marie. When breakfast ended, Felix and Hiller headed out to the markets. They had planned to compose music in the day and wanted snacks while doing so. As they skimmed the apples and oranges, the girl selling the imported fruits called to Felix, "Come here." "Yeah," Felix went to her. She pointed to the dragon fruit. "I'll give you a deal on the dragon fruit. They need to go before they spoil." "I'll buy two so my friend and I can both try it." Felix made his purchase. Hiller found a few plums, then they left the market. And returning to the apartment, Felix put the fruit in a bowl and set it on the table. It looked quite pretty with the pink and green dragon fruit beside the purple plums. Hiller grabbed a folio of his compositions in progress. Felix took his folder from a shelf. The two composers sat opposite of each other, writing in peacefulness, dipping pens in the same inkstand. Their silence only broke on rare intervals by a joke or other. They needed not the piano through the entire setting. In a break, Hiller grabbed a dragon fruit to try. While breaking it open with a knife, Felix giggled, finishing up a piece. "What did you write?" Hiller was curious. "A piece inspired by yesterday's wine." Felix took the other dragon fruit for himself. Upon biting it, its sweet taste was kiwi-like. Hiller took Felix's paper to examine it. It was titled Liebe und Wein, Opus 50, No. 5. "I believe it would sound best by a group of drunken men, but not too drunk, just enough to sing with jolly," Felix stated. Hiller chuckled, then noticed Felix grab a large score. When seeing the title, he recognized that it was the recent Lobesang Felix had completed. It was already in print. Hiller asked, "Why are you still penning on that? Is it not finished?" "Revising," Felix corrected. "Every brushstroke counts." He adjusted dynamic markings. Hiller then noticed drafts of the work laying nearby. The system Felix used in concern to writing the choruses puzzled him. He questioned in reproach, "Why are you using C clefs for all of the voices, and why is the alto line in the soprano cleft? It makes everything inconsistent." "You are perfectly right, but it is not my fault. It was Zelter's way, and I accustomed myself to it from the very first," Felix admitted. Hiller turned back to his own work. He had a few pieces for piano that could be completed by supper. When the hour of supper did come, Johann set the table for a scrumptious meal of baked potatoes. He had excellent cooking skills, causing everyone to make quick work of the food. Afterwards, Felix and Hiller went to the parlor, where the piano was situated. It happened to be acquired from the committee of the Gewandhaus, presented to Cecil after Felix settled in Leipzig with his new wife. It was an excellent instrument. Felix and Hiller used the remainder of the evening to test out their compositions. The next day rendered similar to the last. Sharing ink at the dining table, Felix held a completed D minor trio with immense satisfaction. Hiller looked at it, but his expression gave way to worry. In his opinion, he found a small misgiving. "Those broken chords in the piano passages seem a bit old-fashioned, does it not? I think they shouldn't be broken, and played normally. It should have richness of passage. Do you think that this would make the thing any better? This piece would be the same, and so it may remain as it is." Felix crossed his arms, like a child refusing to listen. "But," Hiller answered, "you have often told me, and proved to me by your actions, that the smallest touch of the brush, which might conduce to the perfection of the whole, must not be despised. An unusual form of arpeggio may not improve the harmony, but neither does it spoil it, and it becomes more interesting to the player." Felix replied with nothing, and went to the piano to prove his point over Hiller, and vice versa. They worked it over and over. In the end, Hiller was triumphant in changing Felix's view. In turn, Felix, with his conscientiousness, had to take the lengthy task of rewriting the whole pianoforte part. It pained him, but the piece would turn out better among musicians, as it would allow them to show off their skills. After much correcting, Felix suggested, "Why don't we do something else besides bicker over our ways? I say we should invite Herr David with us for a walk to the Rosenthal." "All right," Herr Hiller complied, putting his music away. They both grabbed their coats and headed down the cold street. There, at my apartment, they invited me to join them. I had finished my practice and work, so took the stroll far out into the Rosenthal with them. Felix suggested, "We should stop at the cafe and play a game of billiards." "I'm game," I answered. Hiller shrugged, "Sure." In truth, he believed Felix's latest passion for billiards to be a very passing indulgence. Hiller had played much, but admitted knowing nothing of the game. He couldn't judge if Felix was as clever at it as he was in everything else. When entering the cafe and beginning a game, the visiting continued. Felix liked repeating or bringing up any funny expression, joke, or piano passage he liked. While speaking about piano, he stated, "We should have brought Herr Schumann along. He would have had much to say about the music we talk about. I think highly of his opinions." Robert is too busy in his life right now with work, newspapers, and trying to approach Clara in marriage, I informed. It could take years, as I heard that Herr Wick is causing all sorts of scandal against Robert. "Really, what sort of things?" Felix questioned. "All dreadful lies that Robert cannot sustain a living. Herr Wick wants money from both Clara and Robert." "I hope things work out for them soon." Felix hit a ball with the stick, missing the hole. He sighed in frustration. Billiards were not his forte in reality. Hiller's stay at the Mendelssohn home soon added to a few days. He decided it was time to find his own lodgings, so as to not burden the family. A nice hotel suited, in which he could retreat and be alone. The choice also alluded to the fact that being around Felix all so often made it bound to catch him in a fit of frustration or irritability. The happy, innocent, carefree man could turn into the most heated creature imaginable. Whether it were a bad day or a case of writer's block, Felix's energy could channel sourly in a flash. Hiller happened at his home on one such occasion. Johann answered Hiller's knock and let him in. The poor servant seemed tired. Grunts of frustration could be heard coming from the parlor. Hiller headed there and found Felix sitting at the writing desk, scribbling on a manuscript. Other papers sat about, crumbled up or torn. Felix furiously scratched at the desk, not noticing Hiller watching. Hiller felt frightened at his friend's fury towards himself. He stood quietly, deciding not to consult him yet. Felix's anger soon cooled, but he became restless in a feverish way. He snapped at himself in almost a crying tone. "Why can't I just get it? Why can't I just write it? What is wrong with me? I'm stupid. Ugh." "What is the matter with you?" Hiller finally called. "There, I have been sitting for the last 4 hours trying to alter a few bars of a song and can't do it." Felix threw his pen. Hiller glanced towards one of the bedrooms where Cecil stood. She rolled her eyes. "It's that sort of day, where I'm caring for 3 children. Hiller turned back to Felix to see what he was grumbling over. It was a quartet for men's voices. He had 20 different versions, most of which would have satisfied anyone. "What you could not do today for hours, you will be able to do tomorrow in as many minutes." Hiller grabbed Felix's hand to stop him from scratching at the desk. Felix calmed down after the sensible suggestion. Hiller decided he wasn't going to visit long. Before heading out the door, he told Johann, "Be sure Felix doesn't drink anything with caffeine. No coffee or black tea, only herbal." "I think that's for the best," Johann agreed. Hiller made his leave. As soon as he did, Felix called to Johann. "Johann, fetch me a fine brew of coffee." "I'll get you something." Johann went to the cabinet and chose chamomile tea with honey to calm him and the household. "Felix," I called from the entryway of the Mendelssohn apartment during a busy afternoon. "The orchestra needs you to play Beethoven's 5th piano concerto for a concert. Clara is under the weather." "Just a minute," Felix shuffled about in the parlor, fumbling drawers. I waited by the door, glancing at the clock. It was 12:30, and I needed Felix to the Gavant house before 1. I was to conduct, as the concertos were my duty. All became quiet in the parlor. I called again. We need to go now. And getting no answer, I walked into the house more. To my surprise, I found Felix at the writing desk, sitting in his concert attire. He was in the middle of penning a piece for men's voices with much ease, his mood chipper in doing so. Felix then stood from his seat, ready to go. Cecil was dressed to attend as well, leaving the children with Johann. Upon getting in a carriage through the concert house, a sore throat began to besiege Felix. By the time we reached our destination, he developed a cough. Cecil, with her wifely worries, asked, "Are you all right to play?" "I'll make it through," Felix assured as the carriage halted. Cecil gave a sigh as her husband ran off to meet with the orchestra. Herr Hiller joined with Cecil as I hurried off to catch up with Felix. The concert hall was packed, but I heard a mix of murmurs. Some were disappointed that Clara wasn't playing, but others were excited that Felix was the fill-in. When it became time to start, Felix entered the stage. He put a handkerchief in his pocket as if he'd just blown his nose. I could tell he had a head cold, yet the man pursued on by sitting at the keys. He sat patiently as I joined the orchestra at the conducting desk. With the gesture of the hand, the musicians burst forth with the strong E-flat major chord. Felix then strode the arpeggios in a grace, yet sniffling from a runny nose. After the first movement, the real struggle came during the adagio as a coughing fit commenced, nearly halting his playing. Some in the audience whispered in suspense, but Felix pulled through. As the concerto went on, the less spirited his playing became, but in an odd sense, it sounded better than his at-home practice. With a sense of relief, he managed to finish the challenging third movement. After the concert, Hiller escorted Cecil outside. They waited for Felix near the front doors. Some ladies nearby spoke of the performance. One sighed, "Oh, that poor Felix. He appeared so tired. I heard Clara Vick was ill. That's why she didn't play." "I dare say," the other lady commented. "I wouldn't call Felix poor. I rather would say that poor Cecil, his wife." "What do you mean?" another asked. The lady explained, "Her husband is such a cruel, inhuman man. He is barbarous to her." Cecil and Hiller pricked their ears in confusion. The ladies were obviously envious, wishing they were Felix's wife. When they walked off, Cecil and Hiller burst into laughter. Felix soon caught up with them. "What has got you two in a laugh?" "Oh, nothing," Cecil caressed her husband's chin. "I have the happiest life with you." Felix smiled and the three headed back to the apartment. Hiller decided to join in dinner as it was still early evening. Felix went straight to the sofa upon returning home. When he was out of sorts, sleep was his best resource. Hiller found it quite strange as he napped for hours, so deep in slumber. When Johann deemed dinner ready, Felix woke with capital appetite. Everyone ate a nice beef stew together. Afterwards, Felix spent time visiting with Hiller. In speaking, when a conversation was quiet or calm, Felix had a tendency to jump into a comical subject or a serious one. As he and Hiller lounged calmly, Felix asked in a slight burst, "Do you believe in the progress of humanity?" "How? In what way do you mean?" "I don't speak of machines and railways and all those things, but I ask if you think that mankind becomes better and more remarkable as time goes on." "I guess it doesn't cross my mind much." Hiller felt indifferent. Felix gave way to a yawn. It was only a quarter of an hour of conversation, and he said with the air of a spoiled child, "I am still quite tired." He laid back on the sofa, stretched out, mumbling slightly, "Rest is so delicious." Within a few minutes, he gave way to soft snores. Cecil walked in as Hiller stood from his chair. She glanced at Felix, apologizing. "Sorry he's being such a bad host. He can go on in that way for days, but then is fresher than ever." "Nature is his care for his busy life," Hiller gazed at Felix, who was shifting about in his sleep. "That may be, but I'm calling for a doctor tomorrow. I think he's unwell," Cecil stated. Hiller then mentioned, I thank you both for hosting me. But tomorrow I am to start my journey to Italy. It will be early morning, so please give Felix my goodbyes. I will. Thanks for coming. Cecil smiled. With that, Hiller made his leave. Felix awoke the next morning still on the sofa, groggy as ever. He snoozed, but was unpleasantly bothered as someone lightly pressed on his throat. In opening his eyes, he realized it was a doctor checking his vitals. Cecil stood nearby, waiting to hear the diagnosis. Felix felt he had a head cold, but nothing serious. He forced himself to sit up. I assure, I am fine. It's only a chill. Felix didn't enjoy the unexpected checkup and tried to hasten it by perking up as to seem healthy, but inside he was tired to the bones. Cecil stepped up. Is it really only a chill? You've been sleeping for hours upon hours since the concert yesterday. I see, the doctor checked Felix's eyes. They were that of an exhausted man. The doctor stated, I believe you're overworking yourself with conducting and piano. It wasn't the best idea to perform with the cold, as it may turn severe. I know that September and October are the start of the busy season, so I suggest you rest the weeks before then. Your body needs it. I will rest. Felix fell asleep mid-sentence. The doctor turned to Cecil. Next time he wakes, try to get him to bed. It will be better for him. The doctor left. Cecil noted everything to be sure her husband obeyed the orders. The whole of the August month consisted of rest and regaining health. It felt like fresh air, but doing completely nothing got boring. Felix thought the extra time to be suitable for composing, but Cecil set limits. When September came, the concert proposals were back in motion, and the next weeks were booked. Felix's symphony, Lobesang, was in high demand, attracting the likes of the royal courts in Germany. The King of Saxony attended the second performance at the Gewandhaus. At that concert, the chorus and orchestra sounded their best. Felix gestured the cadence at the end of the first half, deeming it perfect so far. Before the start of the second half, someone interrupted by tapping his shoulder. Felix glanced to find Herr Schleinitz. It's the middle of a concert. What do you want? Felix whispered in annoyance. The king wants you, Schleinitz pointed towards the audience. Felix turned around to see the King of Saxony nod at him. Since it was an order of royalty, Felix abandoned the conducting desk, leaving the perfect performance on hold to pass through the double row of ladies. Once Felix reached the seats of the royal court, the king spoke in the most friendly manner. Excuse my halting the concert, but I couldn't help but tell you how superb the music sounds. I am happy that your majesty is pleased. Felix gave a polite bow. Bitte now, carry on. The king gestured him to the stage. Felix obeyed and continued with the second half of the symphony. The orchestra and chorus echoed with a pleasant reverb through the large hall. When the grand performance finished, the clapping lasted minutes upon minutes. Every musician bowed, then dispersed. As Felix packed up his music, whispers behind him gasped. The king is coming to him this time. Felix turned around, and the King of Saxony was passing through the row of ladies. My dear Mendelssohn, that was the most excellent concert I've ever attended. His manner of speech had such animation. That music resonated through my ears. Those voices, the orchestra, everything was so perfect. Bitte, you must come to Dresden. I am sorry, I am due in England in a few weeks. If you come to Birmingham, you would hear it again, Felix explained. The king sighed, then patted Felix on the shoulder. I shall be patient for your return. On the 18th of September, Felix arrived in the city that was a second home to him, London. He was to be in Birmingham, but decided to make time to stay at Chester Place with the Mochelli's family. Cecil stayed home in Leipzig with the children. When Felix entered Chester Place, Ignaz greeted him. Welcome. You've made it an hour before dinner. Klingman and Mr. Chorley have adjoined. Excellent. Felix had excitement as he saw little Felix Mochelli's frolic about. When the boy noticed Felix Senior, he paused. In a burst of unexpectedness, little Mochelli's ran to Felix and tapped his hand. Tag, you're it. I'll get you. Felix immersed himself into the child's game. He chased and managed to tag him. The two ran about the house, and it went on vice versa. At times, little Mochelli's jumped with so much energy, it made the house near shake. Felix, Charlotte scolded her child. Both Felix and little Felix looked to her. Charlotte looked towards little Felix. Don't be jumping. Why don't you and Felix go do something more calm, like sketching? Yes, Mum. The young boy grabbed a sketchbook. Felix watched him doodle with much interest. Little Felix penciled a tree, then tried to sketch an axe to chop it down. Yet he wasn't sure how to start it. He made a line, but already felt dissatisfied. Felix Sr. instructed, Here, let me help. He took the pencil, forming a line to make the drawing the desired object. Young Mocelli smiled and continued on. Dinner soon commenced, and everyone took their seating. Felix sat between Klingman and Ignaz. Mr. Chorley sat across from them along with Charlotte and the children. It was a handsome meal of shepherd's pie. As the group took their plates, Mr. Chorley asked Felix, So that hymn of praise is to be performed in Birmingham? Yeah. Are you and Klingman joining Ignaz and I? Felix questioned as he put extra cheese on top of the minced meat. Klingman confessed, I believe the trip shall be only you and Ignaz. I am bombarded with work, and Mr. Chorley is as well. I will be coming to Leipzig, Mr. Chorley added, if Ignaz still has plans to go. Yes, I am stopping there on my way to Prague. Ignaz politely took a bite of vegetables. Felix brightened. I had no clue you were coming. I do offer my home if you need a place to stay. I'll see, but a hotel will do me fine, Ignaz assured. The evening ended after finishing the hearty plates. Dessert consisted of creamy English trifles. On the 20th of September, Felix and Ignaz arrived at the Stork Hotel in Birmingham. It wasn't tall, but it had a quaint tavern feel. The rooms were clean and comfortable. Their stay in Birmingham was a busy one right from the start. Before unpacking anything, Felix was requested to rehearsals for the concert that afternoon. Though the day was already booked, he found time to make sketches for Felix and Emily Mocelles. The concert hall was settled in an interesting neighborhood, full of commotion. The brick streets were bustling with nicely dressed people. Everything about Birmingham had a properness to it. The feel of it made time slip away. Felix felt as if one second he were penciling in a sketchbook, then in rehearsals the next. The orchestra was organized and always ready. Soon he was conducting the hymn of praise before a massive audience. After finishing, the audience left, leaving the concert hall in an echo of silence. Felix stuck around the stage with a group of friends, including Ignaz. A large organ had been built into the wall of the concert house, so Felix felt the need to check it out. For 3/4 of an hour, he played as if he'd neither been hearing nor conducting, only as if the day had just begun. Felix and Ignaz returned to the hotel and had supper in the tavern. There were foods in Birmingham that Felix had not tried before. Though he hated butter, his favorite dish became bread and butter pudding. The soft bread with the freshly melted butter appealed to his taste. He obtained the recipe to take home. Before leaving back to London, Felix roamed the street and happened upon a fabric shop selling sewing supplies. He remembered that Charlotte was struggling to get projects finished, as her old pair of scissors had dulled, so Felix purchased a fine new pair. Hours later, in a carriage, Felix and Ignaz returned to Chester Place, but not to stay long. Ignaz packed for a trip through Germany to Prague. While he was busy, Felix presented Charlotte with the scissors. She had much happiness, as her fabric work would be much easier. In turn, she presented him with a new cravat, another that he would have to figure out. Felix tried to tie it on the spot, but couldn't get it to sit right on his shirt collar. These new cravats are so hard to tie. Pin it up, Charlotte pronounced the magic words. All problems were solved. By the time the ordeal with the cravat ended, Ignaz was ready to go. Charlotte gave Felix an umbrella to borrow, figuring Ignaz could bring it back. At the harbor, the luggage was piled together. Mr. Chorley was still on his way. Felix sketched the scene in the meantime. A sad gray chill filled the surroundings whenever leaving London. Chorley soon showed up, and the 3 travelers carried their belongings on the ferry. Felix had much in his hands, but managed. When stepping on the dock to board, he dropped the umbrella. It fell in the water, and the folded thing sank. Ignaz gave an irritated sigh, as it was technically his. Felix had never made Mr. Mocelles upset, so fell in utter silence. He settled his luggage, feeling a complete klutz. The stuffy air only lasted so long as the harsh waters towards Germany made Ignaz forget about the umbrella. Before reaching Leipzig, the group made rest stops in Hamburg and Berlin. In Berlin, Felix paid a visit to his family. His mother and siblings were living well. Paul was now married and making a life at the bank house. Leia still had plenty of company at the estate with Fanny and Wilhelm living nearby. She was satisfied as long as her grandchildren visited. Felix and Ignaz also paid a visit to the concert house in Berlin, where Felix sketched the layout of it. He couldn't help but doodle music as well. In finally coming to Leipzig, Troilli and Mocelles settled in a hotel. Felix went home, happy to be with his family. His children missed him ever so. Carl jumped at him until he picked him up. Cecil held little Marie. The child reached for her father, so Felix cuddled both Cecil and Marie. Carl butted in, of course. The relief of being home cured every ounce of stress. In the evening, Felix invited Ignaz and Troilli to dinner. Johann began cooking a large chicken pot pie to share. It gave a pleasant smell through the home. The children impatiently waited for the food. Ignaz and Troilli looked about the home, impressed with the cozy atmosphere. Felix got them settled in the parlor with some light coffee, then said, "Excuse me a moment, I'll be back." He ventured off to a room down the hall. As Felix was gone, little Carl came into the parlor, intrigued by the guests. He listened to them speak while heading for the piano. Ignaz glanced at Carl with a smile. The boy asked, "Do you play like my papa?" "I don't know," Ignaz set his cup down. He sat next to Carl. "Let's find out." Ignaz held his arms towards the keys. Instead of placing his fingers, he made his hands into fists and began playing melodies as so. Carl giggled loudly while watching. Felix came back to the parlor, laughing at such a sight. "Dinner is ready," Johann called. Everyone went to the dining room and sat around the table. The large supper pie looked so appetizing. Felix told Johann, "It looks beautiful. Good job." "Danke. There is another pie as well, a dessert one." He brought a pecan pie to the table. "It is for after the healthy stuff." He eyed the children and Felix. Johann joined the table and everyone began eating. Felix mentioned, "Tomorrow evening there is to be a musical party. Herr David has been organizing it as I've been gone. The orchestra, chorus, and guests are to be there." "Sounds like fun." Mr. Troilli sipped some wine. Johann then stood, "Oh, I almost forgot. I tried that recipe you gave me, Felix." He left and came back with a plate of bread and butter pudding. Felix looked at it with excitement. Cecil had confusion. "I thought you hated butter." "I do, but in this dish, it tastes good." Felix took a few scoops of the pudding. That next evening, I watched in satisfaction as many guests poured into the Gewandhaus for the party I had organized. There were 300 invited, plus the chorus of 140 voices and the orchestra. Everyone had excitement as the champagne passed around. A few musicians began to play tunes to entertain the oncoming guests. I waited patiently for Felix as I had not seen him since he took his trip to Birmingham. Many guests stopped to speak with me, all asking, "Herr David, are you going to play tonight?" Yeah, of course," I pandered in reply. A few minutes before the hour, Felix came walking with Ignaz, Cecil, and another man through the doors. It made the crowd all the more eager, whispering, "Mendelssohn and Mocelles both have come." The group of four spotted me right away. When they reached me, Felix introduced the man I had not seen before. "Fernand, this is Mr. Troilli. Mr. Troilli, this is Herr David. How do you do?" Troilli shook my hand. I nodded. "Very well, danke." Our group then proceeded towards the stage. Guests now were scattered and in a chatter with their French bubbly and hors d'oeuvres. Felix jumped right into the party as he liked anything social. Cecil kept at his side as he noticed a gaggle of ladies encircling him. While most ladies were kind towards them, a few whispered and gazed at Cecil, still wishing to be in her place. Though Cecil heard every remark, Felix was oblivious to it as his heart only looked to his precious gem of a wife. Soon the chorus and orchestra beckoned me to the stage. Felix was distracted in an animated conversation, so I took the back of his coat collar and pulled him away from the circle of guests. Felix noticed the waiting musicians, so followed me on the stage. After I sat in my chair with my violin, Felix stood with his hands raised to conduct. Every musician gave him a tilt of the head. His baton wasn't in his hand. He noticed and pulled one from his sleeve. It made the orchestra chuckle. The party only got better with good music. Some serious and other ones for fun. It made for a memorable night. The time came all too soon for Ignaz and Mr. Chorley to make their leaves. For Mr. Chorley, he had to head back to England straight away. Ignaz was continuing his journey to Prague to visit his mother. Felix asked Ignaz sadly while helping him gather luggage, "When is your carriage coming?" "Well, this time I decided to try something new. I'm going to take the train to Prague." "Oh, interesting," Felix felt curious as the rail system was becoming more and more popular. Over the last few years, train stations were being built in each city. There was one in Leipzig. Felix took the carriage with Ignaz to the station to check it out. When they arrived, the train's whistle blew like a steamboat. Towards the front, railmen were preparing coal to burn. Ignaz stated, "Well, I guess I'll find out how fast this will get me to Prague." As the whistle blew once more, Ignaz boarded. He waved as the train chugged out of the station. Felix waved back, finding such a machine interesting. He then returned home in a dull quietness. After the leave of guests, the days at the house became calm with rest. It felt good to be back in normal, healthy routine. Not too busy, but not too lazy. Whenever Felix worked at the writing desk in the parlor, little Carl continuously went to the piano asking, "How does Uncle Mochelis play?" Felix set his pen down and sat by Carl. He tried to imitate Ignaz's funny way of playing with his fists. The melody he tried was an A-flat, 6/8 time. It sounded quite miserable, but entertained Carl. A knock at the door interrupted the bonding moment. Felix got up to answer, finding his brother Paul. "Come in," Felix smiled at the unexpected visit. He guided him to the parlor. Johann gathered a tray of tea together. Paul seemed to be on important business, as he had a folio of various papers. When Felix sat next to him with the hot herbal water, Paul began, "I have come with an important engagement. Remember when I mentioned that Frederick William IV wanted to organize an Academy of Music in Berlin? Well, now that he has been crowned king, he has furthered the plans for a school of arts. Really, that would be good for Berlin. Of course, there is the Sing Academy, but a school dedicated to the teaching of specific subjects would do the city well." Felix nodded with satisfaction. Paul explained further. "There are to be 4 classes, painting, sculpture, architecture, and music. A director will be appointed for each subject. The king has officially chosen you to direct the music department." Paul handed him a letter of approval. "You mean he appointed me a position that I know not much of, let alone fully agree?" Felix tilted his head. "Well, the school is not formed yet, so there is nothing to worry about now. But it is the king that appointed you. Once again, I strongly suggest you comply. There will be plenty of concerts to conduct at the Royal Theatre, sacred and secular. You'll make a good sum and be close to the family home. Mutter misses you." "It sounds good, but what about my position here? I do not want to give it up. I am fortunate with my salary here in Leipzig." "Well, Herr Massau, a correspondent of the king, sent me this to give you." Paul handed Felix a letter of Frederick William, himself discussing a sum of 3,000 thalers. Felix looked at it, still doubtful. Paul pushed, "It is the King of Prussia we are talking about. I do want to please His Majesty, but for now I shall keep my reserve of the matter until the plans are more detailed. I promise to visit Berlin in the spring, but I tell you that I do not want to foolishly give up my station here at the Gewalt House." "There is still time to think," Paul stood up. "Like I said, the academy is still being planned out, so you don't have to leave Leipzig for a while." He grabbed his coat to leave for his hotel. As soon as the door shut, Felix gave an anxious sigh, wondering what mess this would turn out to be. Before the end of 1840, Felix hosted a dinner party at his home, where friends came to sing and eat roast beef. The celebration was in part for his friends Robert and Clara, who were both now Schumann. They had been wedded for a few months. Felix had not the chance to do something for them, so decided this to be a perfect opportunity. As dinner commenced, Robert sat between his bride and Felix. He grabbed a score from a folder and showed Felix, explaining, "This is my newest work. I'm having it copied. Is there any way to have it performed at the Gewalt House?" "Let me see." Felix examined it. It was titled Spring Symphony. The music looked well, quite well, in fact. Felix nodded. There shall be a concert early in the new year. Don Cochon, Robert cheered, becoming the happiest a man could be. He gave Clara a light kiss in his joy. Sleinitz, who was sitting across from Felix, asked, Felix, so I hear you are to be in Berlin sometime in the spring. It's only a short visit to see what the king has planned for the academy there. He appointed me director, but I don't know what all of the details are. I don't want to abandon Leipzig, Felix noticed Cecil, who was beside him, becoming troubled in expression. He forgot to tell her the news. After everyone left for the evening, Cecil stayed at the table with Felix. She spoke her mind. Felix, I don't think you should go to Berlin. You were gone so much in England, and I don't think I can handle moving the children to a new city. I know, honey. I don't want to move either. That is why I'm only visiting, to try to organize someone else to be director. It is not for a few months yet. After I conduct Robert's symphony, I will try to make my trip to Berlin as short as possible. I do want to visit my family. Paul told me that my mother is missing me terribly. Paul is trying to get you to stay in Berlin. He's just doing what the king wanted, Felix made an understanding tone. Cecil added, there's something else, another reason. We have a nice home here, and it's been so good to the children. She trailed off. And? Felix wanted her to continue. Cecil blushed. With our growing family, it will only make it more of a challenge. You're pregnant again? Felix jumped in excitement. Cecil hugged him tightly. I feel that this is the best place for us. I know, Felix embraced with many kisses. Little Carl peeked from around the corner. Ew. Carl, it's bedtime. Felix went to the boy and picked him up. Little Marie had been put to bed before the dinner party. Carl fussed. Nine bed, chocolate. It's too late for sweets. If you don't sleep, you'll have no energy for tomorrow. Felix tucked him in. He sat beside him, humming him to sleep. It put Carl in deep slumber right away. After the children were settled for the night, Felix went back to the parlor where Cecil sat. The fireplace illuminated the room. He sat next to her to enjoy the peaceful night at home. Cecil turned to him and they both had a moment of cuddling. Felix assured, I will not give up our life in Leipzig.